Hi, I'm Dr. Romesh Senewiratne, and today I'm going to share with you some of my work on the neurobiology of music. This is part of an integrated model of how sound and music affect us. The early neural processing of sound begins in the inner ear with conversion of sound vibrations into electrical signals. This occurs in the cochlea of the inner ear, and the chemical electrical signals are transmitted along the auditory nerve to the brainstem. This is a simplified diagram of the transduction of sound. The vibrations hit the eardrum or tympanic membrane, transmitted through the middle ear to the inner ear. There, the organ of Corti is involved in transducing the sound vibrations to electrical chemical impulses which travel to the thalamus and are relayed to the auditory cortex. From the auditory cortex, the sound signals are transmitted to other areas of the brain where they affect the hypothalamus, the pituitary, and the pineal, as well as the autonomic nervous system and the cerebellum shown at the bottom of the brain. This diagram shows some of the pathways that I have been exploring that seem to be involved in the processing of music after the sound has reached the thalamus. This diagram shows the precortical, subcortical structures in green, the cochlear nucleus, superior olivary nucleus, the lateral lemniscus, and the inferior colliculus. That means all sounds, musical sounds and other sounds, all travel up this pathway in the brainstem and midbrain through to the thalamus, which transmits the sound vibrations to Heschel's gyrus. It's colored in this diagram. And Heschel's gyrus is mostly buried from view in the transverse fissure. You can see the location of Heschel's gyrus running medially to laterally on each side of the brain in the temporal lobes, adjacent to the insula. Heschel's gyrus is shown in yellow in this diagram. The numbers indicate points that stimulated complex auditory experiences when the Canadian neurosurgeon Wilder Penfield probed them with an electrode in the 1950s. These are the secondary auditory cortex. So the secondary auditory cortex lies immediately adjacent to the primary auditory cortex, which is shown in the rainbow colors in this diagram. But other areas of the brain, such as the area shaded in purple in this diagram, are also involved in music processing. And this is an area called the precuneus, which recent studies have suggested acts as a mental metronome, maintaining a steady rhythm when we listen to music. Now, the parietal lobe is extensively connected with the visual cortex and also the auditory cortex. And there are also many auditory and visual associations that are very obvious in the descriptive terms that we use when we talk about music. The structure shown in red is the basal ganglia. It's long been known that the basal ganglia were involved in movement. More recently, evidence has suggested that the basal ganglia are also involved in emotions, especially pleasurable emotions. And the thalamus, which is shown as the oval structure in this diagram, is another important area, firstly for its medial geniculate nucleus, which relays the sound to the primary auditory cortex, shown in the green and blue in this diagram. The thalamus then receives the auditory signals back again from the secondary auditory cortex and is extensively and reciprocally connected with all other areas of the cortex. This includes the insula, which is shown in this diagram immediately anterior or in front of the primary auditory cortex. Recent neuroimaging studies have shown the insula to be involved in a range of complex functions relating to music and language, as well as many other functions. The well-known Broca's area and Wernicke's area are speech generation and speech comprehension centers, respectively. And these are adjacent to the secondary auditory cortex, which forms a ring around the primary auditory cortex, shown in green. This is on the left side of the brain. It is interesting to consider what the analogs of these areas on the right side might do. These structures can be seen better in a transverse section of the brain. You can see the location of Wernicke's area in the posterior temporal lobes, Heschel's gyrus, which is shaded over here, and Broca's area. And in the next diagram, Heschel's gyrus is shown in yellow, and some possible pathways of the electrical impulses from the primary and secondary auditory cortex to visual areas at the back of the brain and to the frontal lobes and to the parietal areas. The thalamus is extensively connected with all parts of the cortex, and this diagram looks at the processing after the sound reaches the auditory cortex. I'm now going to look at the relevance of some of these connections between the primary sensory areas, the auditory cortex shown in green, the visual cortex shown in blue, and the somatosensory cortex shown in purple. These are the primary areas. The secondary areas are the large expanses of cortex that lie in between these primary areas. And visual associations in music are quite easily identified. We speak of high and low sounds, bright and dull tones, the word brilliant is just one of few of the visual associations that we have with music. And similarly, there are touch and somatosensory associations that we have when we speak of music, and these can stimulate emotional reactions the same way that the actual stimulation of the visual or somatosensory areas can also cause emotional reactions. So the thalamus and the basal ganglia can be seen as sensory integration points that integrate both the senses and the auditory information together with visual, somatosensory, and motor sensations. The medial geniculate nucleus relays the sound to the primary auditory cortex, which sends the sound to the secondary auditory cortex, shown here in the classic study by Melner. The primary auditory cortex is being very closely studied after death by a histological study looking at the relative thickness of the different layers of the cortex. And a great deal is known about the neural connections of the primary auditory cortex in monkeys and human beings, but there is much less that is known about the subsequent processing of sound once it reaches the auditory cortex and how it affects our emotions and our movements and our imagery and the creation of music. The basal ganglia, which I'll talk about shortly, appear to be a key missing ingredient in the models that have been presented of how music affects the brain. The connection of the thalamus with the visual areas, these are the connections between the visual system and the thalamus, and visual associations are also structurally obvious. The visual system runs parallel to the auditory system and becomes integrated in the parvina. This is a more detailed view of the thalamus, which is a complex structure that is involved in our selective attention, and we all know that we can selectively attend to different qualities and elements in music. The medial geniculate nucleus is also a complex structure, and this is only a small part of the thalamus. The basal ganglia provide an input to the anterior thalamus. The basal ganglia, which are shown in this diagram over there, this is a transverse section, a coronal section through the brain, showing the claustrum and the hippocampus. These are structures involved in timing and mental maps. This is the insula, which recent studies have shown are involved in complex imagery, including auditory imagery. You can see that the insula is immediately adjacent to the primary auditory cortex, and it's a basic principle of the neurosciences that adjacent areas of cortex tend to be functionally connected as well. And the limbic system and other cortical areas are connected with the hypothalamus, and the autonomic nervous system is controlled by the hypothalamus, along with the pituitary gland and the pineal organ. So this shows a network of neural structures that result in music having profound effects on our physiology. I'm now going to talk a little bit about recent evidence that the basal ganglia, which have been known for a long time to be involved in movement and urge to movement and Parkinson's disease, that these ganglia are also involved in emotional reactions, particularly pleasurable emotional reactions to music and perhaps to speech as well. The basal ganglia are located deep to the insula, bilaterally. Those are the input nuclei, and the output of the basal ganglia is to the thalamus, which is shown in yellow in this diagram. And the swollen end of the tail of the caudate nucleus is the location of the amygdala. The amygdala has become very well known in recent years because of its known involvement in emotions, and the nucleus accumbens is also involved in emotions, particularly in pleasurable emotions. Recent evidence has shown that music stimulates the amygdala as well as the nucleus accumbens, and it is thought that the neurotransmitter dopamine is released in these structures. Dopamine is also an important neurotransmitter. So there is a pleasure center in the brain, and that's within the basal ganglia. Even though the nucleus accumbens and the amygdala are generally considered to be parts of the limbic system these days. This diagram shows some of the structures that are involved in the processing of music, particularly rhythmic music, and what structures of the brain are involved in our urge to dance, which I call a dance instinct. It also shows how music can have an effect via our emotional reactions. On the autonomic nervous system and the hormonal system, these are maps that I drew in 2009 after reading Daniel Levitin's interesting book, This Is Your Brain on Music, where he drew attention to the role of the nucleus accumbens, and research that he had done in his laboratory in Canada that showed that the nucleus accumbens is stimulated by music, presumably releasing dopamine in the same manner that various drugs of addiction have been shown to cause. This has profound implications for the use of music as a therapy, because it means that music can cause chemical reactions in the brain. As an alternative to drugs. So this is a diagram showing a model of secondary and tertiary emotions. These concepts need to be integrated with the neural structures that are known to be connected with each other. And with recent evidence from MRI scans and PET scans and MEG scans showing the importance of these structures, the striatum, the insula, and the claustrum. The striatum includes the caudate nucleus and the putamen, and these are the input nuclei of the basal ganglia. The output from the caudate nucleus and putamen is to the nucleus known as the globus pallidus or pallidum, and this transmits the information from the basal ganglia to the thalamus, which is shown in yellow in this diagram. The basal ganglia are extensively connected with motor areas of the brain, and the thalamus serves as an integration point between the visual, the auditory, the motor, and other sensory inputs, whilst also being connected with the frontal lobes, parietal lobes, and occipital lobes, selectively directing our attention . This is a diagram showing the extensive connections of the cortex with the thalamus. You can see that the medial geniculate nucleus is only a very small part of this complex structure. This is a diagram showing some of the consequences or the neural structures involved in emotional reactions, and the hypothalamus is a key control point through its influence on the pituitary and its influence on the pineal organ, which secretes melatonin during the night under the influence of the autonomic nervous system. A summary of the basal ganglia's role in music. It appears to be involved in perception of rhythm and timing, together with the cerebellum, an urge to movement and rhythmic movement, together with the cerebellum and the frontal lobes, especially the motor areas, with mood and emotions, though the effect of mood and emotions cannot be really localized to something like the limbic system, which is shown in red in this diagram. But the connections of the amygdala and the caudate nucleus and basal ganglia with the hypothalamus provide a very clear mechanism by which music can affect our blood pressure, endocrine or hormonal system, our immune health and ability to fight off infections and cancers. There is a possibility that if music can affect our emotions profoundly, that we can use music to treat all these problems. This is an original model of primary, secondary, and tertiary emotions. It's a work in progress. These are some of the diagrams that I've drawn recently, trying to explore some of the chemicals that might be involved in our processing of music. I haven't mentioned the white matter, the corpus callosum, and all the tracts of white matter that connect these different areas of the brain that are growing right throughout our lives. I'll leave that for another time, and I'll discuss at some other juncture the motor cortex and how the motor areas of our brain are integrated with the function of the cerebellum and the basal ganglia in control of dancing and our urge to dance. This is, as I said, a work in progress, and that's all I've got time for today. So I hope you've enjoyed my little exploration of the neurobiology of music. This is Dr. Romesh Senewiratne at Hub 76 in Brisbane.